Hello all. Now today we will be discussing about antifungal drugs. Okay. Now if you talk about fungal infection is also known as mycosis. Okay. Mycotic infection or mycosis. Now this fungal infection is generally of two types. Okay. Either it is superficial mycosis. Okay, which will occur on skin and mucous membrane, or it could be invasive or deep mycosis, which will involve internal organs. Okay, deep mycosis. Now remember, invasive or deep mycosis exclusively develops in immunocompromised people. It mainly develops in immunocompromised people. Okay. Now, let's classify this superficial mycosis. The superficial mycosis is the most common infection. In superficial mycosis is candida infection. Okay, candida or superficial candidiasis. Okay, superficial candidiasis. Now, candidiasis could be invasive as well. Now, second point you will write, the second infection is caused by superficial mycosis is ringworm infection. Okay, ringworm. Now ringworm, it is also known as dermatophytes. It is also known as dermatophytes. It is also known as tinea. It is also known as tinea. And this infection is caused by three species of fungus. You will write, the first species is trichophyton. Trichophyton. Second is microsporum, and lastly epidermophyton. Okay, epidermophyton. So it causes infection of various areas, and those tinea are named as, like if it is occurring of body, it is known as tinea corporis. If it is occurring in legs, it is known as limbs, tinea pedis. Similarly, tinea cruris, if it is occurring in groin area, etc. So we name them as. But there is one exception to this tinea. You will write except. The third infection you will write is tinea versicolor. Tinea versicolor. Tinea versicolor is caused by, rather, a different fungus known as Malassezia furfur. It is caused by a different fungus known as Malassezia furfur. Okay, and finally the fourth superficial infection you must remember is onychomycosis. Okay, onychomycosis. Now onychomycosis is a fungal infection of nails. It can be caused by candida. It can be caused by dermatophytes, and it can be caused by various molds. It can be caused by various molds as well. Okay, so it can be caused by different infections. So remember, ringworm is known as dermatophytes, and it is caused by three species mainly. Okay, except tinea versicolor, which is caused by Malassezia furfur. Okay. Now, what about invasive fungal infection? The invasive fungal infection is caused in immunocompromised people, and it is caused by three types of fungi. So these fungi, they are divided into on the basis of their growth pattern. Okay, either they are yeast-like fungi, either they are yeast-like fungi, or they are molds. Yeast means they will divide by forming hyphae. Molds means they will divide by forming spores, spores or filaments. And the fungi which can do both of them is known as dimorphic fungi. Okay, dimorphic fungi, it can do both of them. So yeast, it will divide with hyphae. Molds, it will divide with spores, and dimorphic both. Now what are those species? In yeast like, you will write, it is the most common candida species. and you will write cryptococcal species. Cryptococcus species. Okay, in molds you will write, in molds you will write it is aspergillosis or aspergillus species. You will write eumycetoma, which causes an infection, madura foot. Okay, then you will write fusarium, fusarium species. You can also write rhizopus species. Okay, now in dimorphic fungi you can write certain fungi like histoplasmosis. So these are dimorphic fungi. Now histoplasmosis, blastomycosis, blastomycosis. Okay, you'll write paracoccidiomycosis. Okay, you'll also write sporotrichosis, etc. There are many more. Okay, just remember, we'll write one point among mold. A very dangerous mold infection you will write is mucormycosis. It is one of the very resistant infection, mucormycosis. It is also under molds. Okay, so this is the general concept of microbiology which you must remember. These are the various fungal infection caused. Now keeping this thing in mind, this is not the part of pharma. Now keeping this thing in mind, let's start with now various antifungal drugs. Okay, antifungal drugs. Now antifungal drugs, they are given for two purposes. Either they are given for superficial mycosis, okay, or they are given for invasive fungal infection. So it has two purposes, invasive fungal infection. Now let's classify these antifungal drugs. Let's classify these antifungal drug. For that you must know the structure of a fungi. If you talk about the structure of a fungi, fungi contains an outer cell wall. It contains an outer cell wall. This cell wall of fungi, it is made up of chitin and beta glucan. It is made up of chitin and beta glucan. Now below this cell wall, fungi, it contains a cell membrane. It contains a cell membrane. The cell membrane of a fungi is made up of a steroid known as ergosterol. Okay, it is made up of a steroid known as ergosterol. Now it has DNA. Okay, it has DNA. Okay, double-stranded eukaryotic DNA. This DNA forms protein. We know that this DNA forms protein, and one of the protein you will write specifically, or a different protein you'll write, is a microtubule protein. Okay, so these are the five targets of drug we will be having which will inhibit them. Hence we have five classes of antifungal drug. The first one will be cell wall inhibitors, then we will be having cell membrane inhibitors, we will be having DNA synthesis inhibitor, protein synthesis inhibitor, and microtubule inhibitors. So these are the five targets of antifungal drugs we have. Okay, so cell wall inhibitors, cell membrane inhibitors, DNA inhibitor, protein inhibitor, and microtubule inhibitors. These are the five target. So keeping this thing in mind, let's start with the first one, that is cell wall inhibitors. Okay, cell wall inhibitors. Okay, now among cell wall inhibitors, the group of antifungal drug is known as echinocandin. The group of antifungal drug which inhibits cell wall is echinocandin. Now what is the mechanism of action of echinocandin? You will write echinocandin inhibit cell wall synthesis. It inhibit cell wall synthesis. How? By inhibiting an enzyme 1,3 beta glucan synthase enzyme. Okay, so this enzyme is required for synthesis of cell wall, and echinocandin, they inhibit the synthesis of cell wall in a fungi. Okay, now what are the drugs we have among echinocandins? The drugs among echinocandin we have are, remember, are only IV drug. So they are only intravenous drug, and intravenous drug, they are mainly given for invasive fungal infection. They are given for invasive fungal infection. They are not given for superficial or topical fungal infection. So keeping this thing in mind, so where they are given in invasive fungal infection, you will write, right now they are not the drug of choice. Remember, they are second line drug in resistant cases or intolerable cases of a very toxic drug known as amphotericin B. So we will be discussing that for all invasive fungal infection, the mainstay of the treatment is amphotericin B. If amphotericin B is intolerable, then we start this drug. But let's see what are the drugs we have. Among echinocandins, we have three drugs. The three drugs among echinocandin we have is CAM. The first drug is caspofungin. Enidulafungin. And micafungin. Okay, so what is the route of administration? IV. They are not given orally. Now let's see what are the uses. Now all these drugs, you are seeing C and A word is coming. C stand for, they are given for invasive candidiasis. They are given for invasive candidiasis. It is also given for invasive candidiasis. It is also given for invasive candidiasis. But this caspofungin, as A word is coming, caspofungin is also given for invasive aspergillosis. Okay. So how to remember? These two drugs are not approved for aspergillosis. So how to remember CA? C for candidiasis, A for aspergillosis. So they are given for invasive infection of candidiasis and aspergillosis, which are resistant to or intolerable to amphotericin B. Okay. Now, what is the advantage of using these drugs? The advantage of using these drugs are, they are not nephrotoxic. Because we will be discussing that the main side effect of amphotericin B will be, amphotericin B will be highly nephrotoxic drug, and these drugs, they are absolutely safe in renal failure. They are absolutely safe in renal failure as well. Amphotericin B will be a very dangerous drug. So it is, this is the advantage they have over amphotericin B. But the point is, these drugs, they are recently been, they are only and only approved for candida infection. And caspofungin is only approved for aspergillosis. Apart from this, no other fungi, they are approved drug. Okay, so they are approved right now for only these two drugs. And the last point you will write is that these drugs are fungicidal drug. They completely kill the fungus. They are fungicidal drugs. So this is a new class of drug. Let's talk about now second class of drug, that is DNA synthesis inhibitor. Again, only a one drug we have among DNA synthesis inhibitor. The name of that drug is 5-fluocytosine. Okay. Any drug which inhibits DNA synthesis, remember, is also known as anti-metabolite. It is anti-metabolite. Okay. It is also known as anti-metabolite. Now, let's see what is the mechanism of action of 5-fluocytosine. Now 5-fluocytosine, it enters into the fungal cell, and inside the fungal cell it gets converted into 5-fluorouracil. Okay, 5-fluorouracil, with the help of a fungal enzyme, with the help of a fungal enzyme known as deaminase. Now remember, this enzyme is not found in human. This enzyme is only found in fungus. So it gets converted into 5-fluorouracil inside the fungus, and it becomes a fake pyrimidine, like fake uracil. And this 5-fluorouracil, remember, it inhibits DNA replication or DNA synthesis. Okay, it inhibits DNA replication or DNA synthesis by inhibiting one enzyme known as thymidylate synthase. It inhibits one enzyme which is required for DNA synthesis, known as thymidylate synthase enzyme. So we will discuss 5-fluorouracil in anti-cancer drug. Okay, so it inhibits. Now what is the use of 5-fluorouracil? We will write, 5-fluorouracil is given orally, and it is never given alone. What does it mean? That this 5-fluorouracil is always combined with amphotericin B. Why it is never given alone? Because of chances of resistance. If it will be given alone, there will be chance of resistance. Hence, it should always be combined with amphotericin B. Okay. Now, it is combined with amphotericin B. Amphotericin B will inhibit cell membrane, and 5-fluorouracil will, amphotericin B will inhibit this cell membrane of a fungi, and 5-fluorouracil can enter very easily inside. So, this combination of 5-fluocytosine with amphotericin B, this combination, remember, is a synergistic combination. It increases each other's effectiveness. As you are seeing, that amphotericin B is inhibiting the cell membrane, and 5-fluocytosine can now go inside. And this combination is the drug of choice, or the treatment of choice, which is sometimes known as gold standard treatment. It is a gold standard treatment for an infection known as cryptococcal meningitis. Okay, it is a gold standard treatment for an infection of cryptococcal meningitis, especially in immunocompromised people or HIV positive individuals. Okay, so the treatment of cryptococcal meningitis is 5-fluocytosine with amphotericin B. Amphotericin B with 5-fluocytosine is the combination, is the treatment for cryptococcal meningitis. Okay, so this is the main drug, amphotericin B, for cryptococcal meningitis, and 5-fluocytosine also increases the effectiveness. Now, what is the side effect of 5-fluocytosine? The main side effect of 5-fluocytosine is bone marrow suppression. Okay, bone marrow suppression. Okay, now let's talk about the third drug. Now, the third drug we have is protein synthesis inhibitor. Okay, now the drug we have among protein synthesis inhibitor is only one, that is tavapadol. The only drug we have is tavapadol. Now this tavapadol, what is the mechanism of action? This tavapadol, it inhibits one enzyme, leucine tRNA synthase, and this enzyme is required for protein synthesis. Okay, now where this tavapadol is used, tavapadol is given topically for toenail infection. It is given topically for toenail infection. Nail infection, remember, is also known as onychomycosis. Okay. So how to remember tavapadol? It inhibits some tRNA. It is given topically for toenail infection. So everything is starting with the word T. Okay, so try to remember. Now let's talk about the fourth class of drug, that is microtubule inhibitors. Okay, microtubule inhibitor. Okay, now again we have only one drug among microtubule inhibitor, but this drug is very important for you, that is griseofulvin. Okay, the drug name is griseofulvin, a very important drug for you. Now griseofulvin, what happens, it inhibit microtubule formation. And remember, microtubule is required for cell division. Because of this reason, there is no fungal cell division. And the fungus cell will not divide, hence, it is a kind of a fungistatic drug. It's a fungistatic drug. It's a fungistatic drug. Okay. Now, where griseofulvin is used, remember, griseofulvin is an oral drug. Okay, it's an oral drug. It is not given topically, because topically it causes photosensitive reaction, and it's an oral drug for, you will write, topical fungal infection, those infection which is occurring on skin. So it is given orally for skin infection of fungi. Why it is given orally for skin infection of fungi? Because when griseofulvin is given orally, it will go to the skin and bind to keratin protein on skin. It gets bind to keratin protein on skin. Because of this reason, it is given orally for topical fungal infection. Okay. Now, which topical fungal infection? You'll write, it is given in dermatophytes. Okay, dermatophytes, or you will write tinea. Tinea, and among tinea, remember, it is the drug of choice for one tinea known as tinea capitis. It is the drug of choice for tinea capitis. Griseofulvin is the drug of choice for tinea capitis. It can be given in other tinea like tinea pedis. It can be given in tinea cruris. Can be given in tinea corporis. But remember, nowadays we have stopped using this griseofulvin in other forms of tinea because resistance have been developed. Is developed in past 2 years. In past 2 years, resistance, there is a widespread resistance to griseofulvin in other forms of tinea. So we will be discussing in other forms of tinea, we will be using other drugs like, you will write, terbinafine. We will be using other drug which we will be discussing in cell membrane inhibitors. We will be using azoles. We will be using other drugs, okay, azoles, etc., because they are now the main drug for tinea, other forms of tinea. But for tinea capitis, the drug of choice is griseofulvin. But what about other skin infection? Remember, griseofulvin, if you talk about other skin infection apart from dermatophytes, griseofulvin is not effective in. Griseofulvin is not effective in tinea versicolor. It is not effective in tinea versicolor, which was caused by Melassezia furfur. Griseofulvin is not effective in cases of candida. Griseofulvin is not effective in cases of candida infection also. Okay, and griseofulvin is not effective in cases of onychomycosis. So it is used as a topical drug for only one type of skin infection known as dermatophytes. While other types of skin infection, it is not effective. But remember, these drugs, azoles and terbinafine, they are effective in these cases also. Azoles and terbinafine, they are also effective in this case, while griseofulvin is not effective in other types of superficial mycosis or skin infection. It is only given in tinea or dermatophytes. Okay, so remember. Now the point is, what is, how we will give some pharmacokinetic. Remember, griseofulvin is given orally, that we know, and it should be given with fatty meals. Why? Because fatty meals increase the absorption of griseofulvin. Okay, increase the absorption of griseofulvin. So it should be given with fatty meals. Now second point is, griseofulvin is a enzyme, that means CYP, enzyme inducer, just like rifampicin, GPRS. Okay, we have discussed already a mnemonic. Okay, enzyme inducer. Now what is the side effect of griseofulvin? Okay, what is the side effect? The most common side effect of griseofulvin is headache. Okay, and it also causes disulfiram like reaction in patients who are alcoholics. Okay, in alcoholics it causes disulfiram like reaction. So because of this reason, griseofulvin, remember, it is not effective in tinea versicolor, candida and onychomycosis, which are the other skin infection caused by superficial fungal infection. Okay, so it is only given in dermatophytes, and there it is given in tinea capitis nowadays. Now the last class of drug we have is the drugs which are acting on cell membrane. Drugs acting on cell membrane. Now we know the fungal cell membrane, it is made up of a steroid known as ergosterol. Let's see how ergosterol is synthesized. First of all, fungus requires a molecule known as squalene. Okay, this squalene gets converted into a steroid known as lanosterol, and this lanosterol forms the fungal cell membrane known as ergosterol. It forms a fungal cell membrane, ergosterol. So this is the fungal cell membrane which is now synthesized. To convert squalene into lanosterol, the enzyme which is required is squalene epoxidases. Okay, squalene epoxidase. To convert lanosterol into ergosterol, the enzyme which is required is 14 alpha sterol demethylase. Okay, demethylase. Okay, so this is how fungal cell membrane is synthesized. Now we have three classes of drug. The three classes of drug which are antifungal drug which inhibit cell membrane are, you write A, P. The first class of drug we have is allyl amines. So these are the drugs now. The first class of drug we have is allyl amines. Now allyl amines, remember, they inhibit squalene epoxidases. Okay, squalene epoxidase enzyme. Then we have azoles. Azoles, they inhibit 14 alpha sterol demethylase enzyme. Okay, so can we say that allylamine will inhibit conversion of squalene into lanosterol, and azoles will inhibit the conversion of lanosterol into ergosterol. And finally, we have a drug, polyenes, in which we will discuss a drug, amphotericin B, polyenes, they will come and they will directly create a pore on fully formed fungal cell membrane. Okay, so what they will be doing, they will create pores, or they will be having sponge-like action, okay, on ergosterol cell membrane. Okay, ergosterol cell membrane. So these are the three classes of drug we have among the drugs acting on cell membrane. You will write that allylamines are predominantly fungicidal drug. Azoles, they are predominantly fungistatic. And polyenes, again, they are the very broad spectrum and a most effective drug are fungicidal drugs are polyenes. Okay. So allylamines and polyenes are fungicidal. Azoles, for most of the fungi, they are fungistatic. For some fungi, they could be fungicidal also. So keeping this thing in mind, let's start with the first drug, that is allylamines. Okay, let's start with the first drug, that is allylamines. Okay, now among allylamines we have various drugs. You'll write the drugs are terbinafine, okay, naphtyphine, and butanaphine. So how to remember? They all are ending with the word same name, phene. Okay, terbinafine. Now these drugs, they are given as a topical drug, topical 1% cream, or they can be given as an oral drug. Okay, and these drugs are only given for superficial mycosis. They are only given for superficial mycosis. They are not given for invasive fungal infection. But if we will be talking about these two drugs, azoles and polyenes, they are given for both superficial fungal infection as well as invasive fungal infection. Okay, so allylamines, they are only given for superficial fungal infection, while azoles and polyenes, they are given for both condition. And for superficial fungal infection, remember, they are given in all cases, on all types of superficial fungal infection which we have discussed. They are given, like they are given in dermatophytes, which is also known as ringworm or tinea. Okay, so all types of tinea they are given. Remember, they are also given for skin or superficial candida infection. Remember, they are given for onychomycosis, and for onychomycosis, they are the most preferred drug. They are now considered as a drug of choice, and they are also given for tinea versicolor. Okay, so it is given for all types of superficial fungal infection. Okay, now what is their main side effect? Their main concern of a side effect is they are hepatotoxic drug. When they are given orally, they are hepatotoxic drug, and they may also cause Stevens-Johnson syndrome and toxic epidermolytic necrosis, a hypersensitive reaction, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, toxic epidermolytic necrosis. Okay, so remember, griseofulvin was only effective in cases of dermatophytes. In all these conditions, griseofulvin was not effective. While these drugs, allylamines, they are also effective in candida, onychomycosis, and tinea versicolor. Now let's talk about the second class of drug, that is azoles. Okay, now azoles, they are given for both superficial fungal infection, and they are also given for invasive fungal infection. Okay, और माइकोसिस. ओके, नाउ दीज अजोल्स दे आर डिवाइडेड इंटू थ्री टाइप्स डिपेंडिंग अपॉन देयर केमिकल नेचर. डिपेंडिंग अपॉन देयर केमिकल स्ट्रक्चर दे आर डिवाइडेड इंटू थ्री. आइदर दे आर नोन एज इमिडाजोल्स. ओके, इमिडाजोल्स, और दे आर नोन एज ट्रायाजोल्स. नाउ रिसेंटली देर इज अ थर्ड वेराइटी ऑल्सो नोन एज थायाजोल्स. Thiazol, it's a third drug recently been approved, and there is a new drug. There is only one drug among thiazol. You'll write that new drug is known as abafungin. This new drug is known as abafungin. So it has a structure of thiazol. So it's a new drug. Just for your reference, you will write it. So it's a kind of azole. But if you talk about these drugs, imidazoles and triazoles, all these drugs, they will end with the word azole. To identify them, they will end with the word azole. So let's classify these azoles now. Now imidazoles, they are divided into two. Either they are given only and only topically on skin and mucous membrane, or they can be given topically as well as systemically. Systemically means it can be given oral and IV. Okay, oral and IV. Similarly, if you talk about triazoles, triazoles is further divided into two. Either it is given topically plus systemically. Systemically means oral and IV, or they are given only and only systemically. That means oral and IV. Understood this point? So imidazoles, either they are given topically or systemically. They are given topically or systemically. So let's write the names of imidazoles which are given topically. So the names you will write are C-O-M-E, come, lost. So C stands for clotrimazole. So clotrimazole is only given topically. It is not given orally or IV. Okay. O for oxyconazole. Miconazole, Econazole, okay, come, lost. L for, you will write Luliconazole, Omoconazole, Sertaconazole, and thioconazole. The imidazole, the only imidazoline which can be given both topically and orally and IV, is, you will write, is ketoconazole. Ketoconazole. So ketoconazole can be given orally as well as IV, apart from topical application. So these are the imidazoline which you must remember. So the only imidazoline which can be given orally or IV is ketoconazole. Now let's talk about the drugs among triazoles. Triazoles. There is only one triazole which can be given topically as well as oral and IV. That is fluconazole. It is the only triazole which can be given topically. Rest all other triazole, they are only given systemically. So the only triazole which can be given topically is fluconazole, and the only imidazoline which can be given systemically is ketoconazole. Now among systemic, you will write VIPI, that is voriconazole, itraconazole, posaconazole, and isavuconazole. So these are the azoles which you have to remember. So the only topical triazole we have is fluconazole. The rest other triazoles, they are only and only systemically. They are not given on skin. So let's keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about first topical azoles. Now topical azoles, remember they are given for superficial mycosis. And remember they are given in all types of superficial mycosis, like dermatophytes, you'll write candida. They all are effective against candida. You'll write dermatophytes. Third, you will write Tinea versicolor. And lastly, onychomycosis. Just like terbinafine. Okay. So let's talk about the first azole. Depending upon the application, the first application is the azole which is given vaginally. Vaginal application for treating a disease known as vaginal candidiasis. For the treatment of vaginal candidiasis, let's see what are the different azoles which are approved. Okay, for vaginal application, three azoles are approved. The first one you will write is clotrimazole. It is available as a pessary. Now pessary is a tablet which is inserted in vagina. Okay, you'll write miconazole. Miconazole is available as suppository. Okay, and terconazole is applied as a cream. Okay, now remember these drugs are given for 3 to 7 days for the treatment of vaginal candidiasis. So these are the three drugs which are available for the treatment of vaginal candidiasis as a topical application on vagina. Second, you will write oral trosh. That means a toffee or lozenges which can be placed in mouth. Okay, the drug which is available as a oral troche is clotrimazole. Okay, clotrimazole, and this clotrimazole is given for oropharyngeal candidiasis. It is given for oropharyngeal candidiasis. Now the third point you will write, they are given as a cutaneous or skin creams, cutaneous application. Okay, cutaneous application. For cutaneous application, rest all topicals are available. All topical azoles are available, which we have list all topical azoles. Okay, and for cutaneous application, they are given for all types of fungal infection, which we have written out here. Here we have written. So all these fungal infection, they are given here. So you can write, they are given for all of these fungal infection. Okay, candida, dermatophytes, Tinea versicolor, and this. Okay, so all these azoles are given here. Now, before coming to the systemic azoles, remember there are certain other miscellaneous drugs. There are certain other miscellaneous drugs which are given for as a topical treatment. They are not azole, they are of different class. So certain miscellaneous drugs which are given for topical skin infection or superficial mycosis, you'll write are, these drugs are Bhutan country. So this is the complete list of the drugs which are given topically. The first drug you will write is benzoic acid with salicylic acid. Okay, this is given in a ratio, you will write 6% plus 3%. It means 6% benzoic acid, 3% salicylic acid, which can be called as 2:1. And this combination is known as Whitfield ointment. It is known as Whitfield ointment. It is generally given for Tinea pedis. Okay, H for you will write haloprogen. Okay, U for un D silenic acid. Okay. T for toll naphthate. And we have already discussed one class of drug which is given topically, terbinafine. Okay, terbinafine. A for azoles, which are given. N for, we will be discussing a drug, nystatin. Nystatin is also given topically. And C for, you will write cyclopyroxolamine. So it's an alcohol, cyclopyroxolamine, which will emulsify the fungal cell membrane. Okay, so Bhutan country. So these are the overall list of the drugs which are given topically for skin infection. Okay, topically for superficial fungal infection. Okay, so let's talk about now systemic azoles. Now remember, systemic azoles can be given for topical as well as invasive fungal infection. The first systemic azole you'll write is ketoconazole. Okay, ketoconazole. And ketoconazole was the first azole to be made. Okay, and it has a very broad spectrum of action. It is effective against variety of fungi. But the point is, when this ketoconazole is given orally and IV, it is highly toxic. We will discuss why. Because of this reason, it is now rarely used. And all the effects of all the uses are overtaken by all the uses of ketoconazole are overtaken by itraconazole. Itraconazole now is generally used in place of ketoconazole because oral ketoconazole is highly toxic drug. But it can be given topically as well. It is given topically for, you can write, seborrheic dermatitis. Or you can write dandruff also. It can be given topically. So it is given as a topical shampoos. Ketoconazole shampoos are available. Now the point is, nowadays, why we don't prefer to give oral and IV ketoconazole? There is a reason behind it. Because of its side effect. Ketoconazole is a highly dangerous drug. First point you will write, ketoconazole is a potent CYP enzyme inhibitor. It's an enzyme inhibitor. It inhibits the degradation of other drug. And remember, all azoles are enzyme inhibitors. All azoles are CYP enzyme inhibitor. Second point, like fungal sterol synthesis, this ketoconazole, it also inhibit steroid hormone synthesis. Steroid synthesis in humans. Okay, so let's see where steroidal hormones are synthesized. It is synthesized in liver. Because of this reason, ketoconazole is highly hepatotoxic. Okay, remember, steroidal hormone synthesis are also occurs in adrenal gland. Because in adrenal gland, you know what happens? Glucocorticoid and mineralocorticoids are synthesized. So it will inhibit the synthesis of glucocorticoid and mineralocorticoid. Decreases glucocorticoid and mineralocorticoid synthesis. Because of this reason, ketoconazole causes adrenal failure. And this adrenal failure, remember, can lead to shock and death because glucocorticoid and mineralocorticoid, they are stress hormone. They maintain our blood pressure. Okay. So in cases of adrenal failure, the patient will die due to sudden death. So remember, this adrenal failure is the most dangerous or the most serious side effect of ketoconazole. most serious side effect. Because of this side effect, ketoconazole can be used for the treatment of adrenal cancers like Cushing syndrome. Okay, adrenal cancer or Cushing syndrome, you can use ketoconazole. Okay, because of its adrenal suppressive effect. And can we write one steroidal hormone, that is testosterone? Testosterone is also a steroidal hormone. It also reduces the production of testosterone. Because of this reason, ketoconazole produces gynecomastia. And it also produces impotency. It also produces impotency. So it inhibits steroidal hormone synthesis in liver, adrenal gland, which could be very dangerous. It can lead to adrenal failure. And it also reduces the production of a steroidal hormone, testosterone. Reduction in testosterone may lead to gynecomastia and impotency. Okay, so remember this point. Now remember these side effects of ketoconazole. It is also seen with itraconazole. It is also seen with itraconazole. But remember, it is not seen with a drug known as fluconazole. So fluconazole is a very safe drug. Fluconazole does not interfere with adrenal gland suppression or testosterone suppression. It does not have any anti-androgenic effect. Okay, fluconazole does not decrease androgen or testosterone level. So it is decreased by ketoconazole and itraconazole. Ketoconazole and itraconazole have effect on steroidal hormone synthesis. So it is not seen by fluconazole. So keep this thing in mind. Let's write the drug fluconazole. Okay, fluconazole. Now systemic fluconazole, it is given orally, can be given IV. And what are the uses of fluconazole? The first use of fluconazole, you will write, fluconazole is the drug of choice for candidiasis. It is the drug of choice for candidiasis. Now which candidiasis? You will write esophageal. Okay, vaginal, oropharyngeal candidiasis. Okay, oropharyngeal candidiasis. The drug of choice is fluconazole. Second use, you will write, fluconazole is also the drug of choice for cryptococcal meningitis. Now remember, meningitis is a very dangerous condition. Okay, for cryptococcal meningitis, it is given for maintenance of long term. In for maintenance, the drug of choice is fluconazole. But for induction of treatment, when the patient will come suddenly, for induction of treatment of cryptococcal meningitis, remember, first of all, we will start the most effective drug, that is amphotericin B. Okay, so amphotericin B is the drug of choice for cryptococcal meningitis induction. When the patient gets stabilized, then we maintain the patient on fluconazole. Okay, so first drug we always start with cryptococcal meningitis is amphotericin B, but maintain with fluconazole. Okay, now the third use you will write of fluconazole is coccidiomycosis meningitis, again meningitis, and here it is the drug of choice for both induction as well as maintenance. Okay, because it is better than amphotericin B. It is better than amphotericin B. While in cryptococcal meningitis, it is given only for maintenance. While coccidiomycosis, the drug of choice is fluconazole. Okay, so try to remember these three C. Okay, now the point is, we will write a point keeping this thing in mind, that fluconazole is a drug among all azoles and among all antifungal drug which has maximum CSF penetration. That is why you are seeing it is given in cases of meningitis. It has maximum CSF penetration. Okay, it has maximum CSF penetration. Second point, you will write, it is the only azole which is removed by kidney, not by liver. Okay, only azole which is removed by the kidney, not by the liver. So it is given in cases of candida, which is a yeast like fungi, cryptococcus, again a yeast like fungi, coccidiomycosis, more of a yeast like fungi. But what about dimorphic fungi and molds? You will write fluconazole is not effective in dimorphic fungi and it is not effective in molds. In dimorphic fungi and molds, fluconazole is not effective. Okay, like example, let's say one dimorphic fungi, aspergillosis, it is not effective. Let's write one mold, mucormycosis, is it effective? The answer is not effective. So it is only given in yeast like fungi. Okay, fluconazole. Let's write the side effect of fluconazole. Fluconazole causes reversible alopecia. Okay, it causes reversible alopecia and it is generally not given in pregnancy because in pregnancy it increases the risk of tetralogy of Fallot in fetus. It increases the risk of tetralogy of Fallots or TOF in fetus, Fallots. So that is why it should be avoided in pregnancy. Let's talk about now the next azole, that is itraconazole. Okay, now this itraconazole, it is mainly given or the drug of choice for dimorphic fungi. Okay, it is the mainstay of the treatment for a fungi known as dimorphic fungi, and you will write some molds. Okay, some molds. Okay, so let's write those dimorphic fungi. The first dimorphic fungi you will write is blastomycosis. The drug of choice is itraconazole. Histoplasmosis. Okay, sporotrichosis. You'll write para, coccidiomycosis. Okay, and in some mold you will write aspergillosis. In some molds you will write aspergillosis. Now this itraconazole is given in these conditions, in these fungi. But remember, in which stage of fungi? Remember, just like fluconazole, it is given for maintenance therapy. Okay, maintenance therapy for non-serious or indolent infection. Okay, for non-serious and indolent infection. But if a patient of these fungal infection comes to you with serious infection, okay, you'll write like meningitis. Hence, in this case, you have to give a rapid induction therapy. You have to kill this fungi very rapidly. So, for all these drugs, for induction therapy, remember the drug of choice is amphotericin B. The drug of choice is amphotericin B. So, where itraconazole is used, itraconazole is given for maintenance therapy, for long-term maintenance. But for initial treatment, we give amphotericin B. And here, for initial treatment, of aspergillosis for induction and serious infection or meningitis, for aspergillosis we give voriconazole. Voriconazole is the drug of choice for induction of aspergillosis. For maintenance, the drug of choice is itraconazole. Okay, so again it is given, itraconazole is given for non-serious indolent maintenance therapy. For induction of these dimorphic fungi, you will add amphotericin B. For aspergillosis, you will give voriconazole. Okay, voriconazole. But you will write that these drugs like amphotericin B and voriconazole, they are not effective in cases of eumycetoma. Okay, they are not effective in cases of eumycetoma. They are also not effective in cases of one infection, one fungi known as Pseudoelaeschleria. Okay, Pseudoelaeschleria. This fungi, remember, it is also known as, okay, pseudo. Here, remember, there is no role of amphotericin B. Here, the drug of choice for both induction and maintenance, both, is itraconazole. The reason is that these drugs, they are not effective in these dimorphic fungi. Okay, it is not effective in cases of these fungi. Here, the drug of choice for both induction and maintenance is itraconazole. Now, let's see what are the side effects of itraconazole. We know itraconazole side effect is same like ketoconazole. Okay, it also inhibits steroid hormone synthesis, which may lead to hepatotoxicity, which may also lead to adrenal failure. Okay, now itraconazole itself can lead to heart failure. It is cardiotoxic also. It can lead to heart failure. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Now the next drug we have is voriconazole. Let's see where voriconazole is used. Voriconazole is the drug of choice for aspergillosis. Remember, for both treatment, induction treatment and maintenance, because it is better than, voriconazole is better than amphotericin B in cases of aspergillosis. Now it is also given in, you will write, Scedosporium, Fusarium and Rhizopus infection. Okay, for maintenance. For induction, the drug of choice is amphotericin B. Okay, it has also been approved for the treatment of candida. But we know for candida, we mainly use fluconazole. It is also effective in candida. But here it is mainly effective. Okay, so all these infections, they are generally molds-like infection. So voriconazole is mainly given for molds. Okay, mold-like infection. So fluconazole for yeast-like fungi, most of them. Itraconazole, most of dimorphic fungi. Voriconazole for molds. Okay. But remember, this voriconazole is not effective in one mold. It is not effective in one mold. That mold is known as mucormycosis. Voriconazole is not effective in one mold, that is mucormycosis. Now, what is the side effect of voriconazole? The most common side effect of voriconazole is visual disturbances. Okay? It causes color blindness, it causes decrease in visual acuity, it also causes increase in QT interval, okay, which may lead to torsades de pointis, and it contain fluorine, which can lead to fluorosis because it contain fluorine. Okay, it contains fluorine. So the most common side effect of voriconazole is visual disturbance. Okay, visual disturbance, and it also causes increase in QT interval. Now you will write the last two azoles, that is posaconazole and isavuconazole. Remember, these are the only two azoles. They are the only azoles we have which are effective in mucormycosis. Apart from this, no other azole is effective in mucormycosis. Only these two azoles are effective in mucormycosis, and they are given for maintenance. It's a very dangerous infection. Remember, the drug of choice for mucormycosis is amphotericin B. The drug of choice for mucormycosis is amphotericin B. So the only two azoles which are effective in mucormycosis is posaconazole and isavuconazole. Okay, so let's talk about the group of amphotericin B. That group of amphotericin B is known as polyenes. The group of amphotericin B is known as polyenes. Okay, now polyenes, what was their mechanism of action? If you remember, polyenes, they create pores on fungal cell membrane. Okay, they have sponge like action which can create pores on ergosterol cell membrane. Remember, it is not inhibiting the synthesis of cell membrane, it is directly going and creating a pore on fungal cell membrane. Remember, polyenes, they are the broadest, they have a broad spectrum of action. Okay, and you'll write they are fungicidal drug, which we have already written. They are fungicidal drugs. Okay, and these polyenes, remember, they are obtained from a bacteria known as Streptomyces. They are obtained from various Streptomyces species. Okay, so keeping this thing in mind, let's see what are the different polyenes we have. The polyenes generally we have is the first polyene, which is given IV, and second we have is topically. Okay, among IV, you will write a very famous drug, amphotericin B. Okay, amphotericin B. This amphotericin B, it is obtained from Streptomyces nodosus. From which Streptomyces it is obtained? Streptomyces nodosus. We have certain topical also, like you will write nystatin, natamycin. So they are topical one, and hamycin. Nystatin, it is obtained from Streptomyces norcei. Natamycin is obtained from Streptomyces natalensis. And hamycin is obtained from Streptomyces pimprina. Now this pimprina, why it is known as pimprina? Because it is obtained in India at a place known as Pimpri. It is obtained in a place known as Pimpri, and it was made in India. Okay, at Pimpri. Now let's see the uses of these drugs and try to remember nodosus, amphotericin B. Okay, now let's see the uses. Let's see first the uses of topical one. Let's see the uses. Let's talk about the first one, that is nystatin. Okay, nystatin. Now nystatin, remember, it is only given for superficial Candida infection. It is only given for superficial candida infection. Okay, and it is made as a nystatin paint. The paint of nystatin is given for oral thrush. Oral thrush means the oral infection of candida. It can be given as an oral suspension. When it is given orally suspension, remember it is not absorbed. It is not absorbed into GIT, but it will be given for, it is effective for intestinal candidiasis. It can be given for intestinal candidiasis. Now the second drug you will write is natamycin. Now natamycin is given as a topical eye drops for fungal infection of cornea known as keratoconusal, that means cornea mycosis. It is an approved drug for keratomycosis, that is a fungal infection of cornea. Now for keratomycosis, what are the drugs we have? We have natamycin topical eye drops. We can give the solution of amphotericin B also. Okay, you can also give silver nitrate. You can also give silver nitrate as well. Okay, so remember. Now let's talk about the most famous drug, that is amphotericin B. Okay, so our amphotericin B, remember it is given IV. And when it is given IV, you will write it is the most effective fungicidal drug we have. Okay, it is the most effective fungicidal drug we have, and it has the broadest spectrum. That means it is effective against all fungi. Okay, it is effective against all fungi. Okay, it is also effective against some protozoa also. It is also effective against some protozoa, because some protozoan, their cell membrane is made up of ergosterol. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. So the first point is in all fungi and some protozoa. Okay, so those protozoa you will write where amphotericin B is given is Kala Azar. It is the drug of choice for Kala Azar, Leishmania donovani, and it is also given in Naegleria species. These are the two protozoa where amphotericin B is given. Okay, these two protozoa, the treatment of choice is amphotericin B, Kala Azar and Naegleria species. Okay, now it is given in cases of all fungi. Okay, like example we will be discussing, and remember there are certain exceptions in certain fungi where amphotericin B is not effective. Those fungal infection where amphotericin B is not effective are, there are four fungi where amphotericin B is not effective. You will write, okay, PEMP, PEMP. Okay, so the first fungi you will write pneumocystis, Gerovecai infection. Here amphotericin B is not effective. Here the drug of choice is cotrimoxazole. Okay, second you will write eumycetoma. Eumycetoma causes madura foot. Okay, eumycetoma. Okay, then you will write microsporidia, and lastly you will write sud Eleuscheria. So these are the four fungal infection where amphotericin B is not effective. In eumycetoma and pseudo Eleuscheria, here the drug of choice is itraconazole. Okay, while in microsporidia, the drug of choice is, for the diarrhea, the drug of choice is albendazole. Albendazole. Or for corneal ulcer, caused by microsporidia, the drug of choice is fumagillin. So this part we have already covered in protozoan infection. Okay, protozoan infection, we have covered this part. Okay, so these are the four species of fungi where amphotericin B is not effective. So let's see in which fungi it is given. So amphotericin B, where it is given, remember amphotericin B is the drug of choice for all serious fungal infection like example meningitis. Okay, it is also the drug of choice for induction of treatment. It is not given for maintenance, induction of treatment of fungal infection. Okay, so you can write certain fungal infection where it is considered as a gold standard drug, the best drug. You'll write the gold standard drug for cryptococcal meningitis is amphotericin B. Okay, it is a gold standard drug for mucormycosis, because these infections are very life-threatening infection. Here the drug of choice is amphotericin B plus all other fungi which we have already discussed. Okay, now let's talk about what is the route of administration. Amphotericin B, remember, it is given intravenously. Okay, and it is given in dextrose solution or glucose solution. Okay, what should be the concentration? Either 5% or 10% dextrose solution. Now remember, this amphotericin B is not given in, it is not given in saline. It should be given in dextrose solution, not in saline, because in saline amphotericin B is insoluble in saline. And what will happen? It will precipitate, the crystals of amphotericin B precipitate in saline. Okay, it is insoluble in saline and it crystal precipitate in saline. Hence, that is why amphotericin B should not be given in saline drip. It should be given in dextrose or glucose drip. Okay, let's talk about now side effects of amphotericin B. There are predominantly four main side effects of amphotericin B. You'll write those four side effects. The first side effect of amphotericin B, you'll write, is allergic or infusion reaction. Allergic or infusion reaction. Second side effect you will write, it causes azotemia. Azotemia is also known as nephrotoxicity. It's a very important point. It is highly nephrotoxic. Third, you will write, it causes anemia. And it also causes arachnoiditis, inflammation of meninges or arachnoid membrane. Okay, arachnoiditis. So these are the four main side effects. Let's talk about the first, that is allergic reaction or infusion reaction. The reason is, when we start the drip of amphotericin B, it produces severe allergic reaction. How to prevent it? To prevent this severe allergic reaction due to amphotericin B, give pre-treatment with NSAIDs, or you can give NSAIDs like Brufen, Paracetamol, etc. You can also give corticosteroid. Pre-treatment with corticosteroid like prednisolone. You can give with pre-treatment with antihistaminic also like diphenhydramine, promethazine, etc. Okay, diphenhydramine, promethazine, etc. So why these drugs should be given before giving amphotericin B? To prevent this allergic or infusion reaction. Now the second point is, it is highly nephrotoxic. Now what kind of nephrotoxicity it produces? Remember, amphotericin B produces renal tubular acidosis. What happens in renal tubular acidosis? There is loss of ions. Now, which loss of ions is seen with amphotericin B? It causes loss of potassium and magnesium. Amphotericin B causes loss of potassium and magnesium, which can lead to hypokalemia and hypomagnesemia. Okay, hypomagnesemia. Now, how we can prevent it? How to prevent nephrotoxicity due to amphotericin B? To prevent this nephrotoxicity due to amphotericin B, give adequate hydration. Okay, give adequate hydration before amphotericin B. Before starting amphotericin B, give adequate hydration. Now, how to give? When the patient, you have to, if a patient, in a patient, if you want to give amphotericin B, before giving amphotericin B, start normal saline. Okay? How much? You'll write at least 2 liters for at least 2 hours. Give 2 liters of saline for 2 hours before starting amphotericin B, because pre-treatment with saline or adequate hydration, it reduces nephrotoxicity. Okay, it reduces nephrotoxicity. Adequate hydration. Okay, so try to remember. Now, it also causes anemia. Now, which type of anemia? You will write it causes. It causes normocytic hypochromic anemia. That means the shape of RBC will be same, while the hemoglobin content will reduce. Okay, and it causes arachnoiditis. When it causes arachnoiditis, when it is given as an intrathecal injection directly into meninges. Intrathecal injection of amphotericin B causes arachnoiditis. So these are the 4 main side effects of amphotericin B, which you must remember. And the most important is nephrotoxicity or azotemia. This you must remember. And how to prevent anemia? To prevent anemia, nephrotoxicity, give adequate hydration with normal saline. And how to prevent allergic reaction? Give pre-treatment with NSAID, corticosteroid or antihistaminics. Okay, now let's see the last point. What is the preparations of amphotericin B we have? Preparations of amphotericin B. Okay, now this amphotericin B, we will write the short form of amphotericin B as AMB. Okay, so the first preparation you will write is AMB. AMB stands for amphotericin B doc. Okay, second you will write AMBCD. Third you will write AMBLC. And lastly you will write LAMB. LAMB. For the first preparation is amphotericin B deoxycholate. Okay, deoxycholate. CD stands for, so DOC stands for deoxycholate. Second, you will write CD. CD stands for amphotericin B colloidal dispersion. Okay, colloidal dispersion. Then you will write LC, amphotericin B lipid complex. And the most important one, or the most famous one, that is LAMB. LAMB stands for liposomal amphotericin B. Okay, now remember this deoxycholate, it is most nephrotoxic. The most nephrotoxic preparation we have is deoxycholate. And colloidal dispersion, you will write it has most allergic or infusion reaction. okay? But what about this liposomal amphotericin B? This liposomal amphotericin B, remember, it is the best one we have. Why? Because it is the safest preparation we have. It is the safest preparation we have of amphotericin B, that is liposomal amphotericin B. What happens in liposomal amphotericin B? This amphotericin B is inserted in liposomes. It is inserted in liposomes. Liposomes are soap-like bubbles. Okay. Now, what is the importance of liposomal amphotericin B? Liposomal amphotericin B is least nephrotoxic among all preparation. It is least nephrotoxic among all preparation. It has least infusion related reactions or allergic reactions. Least. Okay. It causes least anemia. It causes least anemia and it has better penetration into cell. So the efficacy will also increase. Okay. Better penetration into the cell. Because of this reason, in one word, you can write it is the safest drug we have. So the least nephrotoxic or least anemia or least allergic reaction is with liposomal amphotericin B. But there is a disadvantage. The disadvantage of liposomal amphotericin B that it is highly costly. So it is highly costly. So most of the countries it is not available because of its high cost. So this is all about amphotericin B and antifungal drugs. So thank you very much for listening.